Good morning. So we have a fun treat for you today for Zoo View. If you didn't notice, there's a giant python in the grass here at the Kansas City Zoo. This is Louise. She's a Burmese python, and Kaylee from the zoo is here for Zoo View today to tell us a little bit about her. So thanks for joining us, first off. Tell us about Louise. She kind of likes to stretch. I would say you stretch your legs out, but stretch your body out here in the grass every once in a while, right?
She does. This is Louise, our Burmese python. She is 15 years old this year, and she's about 14 and a half feet long. She's 105 pounds, so she's a big lady. And she does enjoy coming out here to get some natural sunlight. We bring her out here so that she gets natural vitamin D. It's really important for reptiles to get that. Just like we need vitamin D, animals need that as well. So, and there's no substitute for natural sunlight. So we definitely like to bring her out here, soak that up. And then we also do like to get her some external exercise so that she can, you know, enjoy the feel of the grass. It's also great for enrichment for her so that she can feel things, you know, like grass and experience wind and smells and all of that kind of thing. So she seems to really enjoy being out here.
It's nice to get her out of the enclosure every once in a while and
yes,
just kind of hang out. We see people here at the zoo starting to watch some onlookers here. This has got to be kind of a neat show for the public, too, when you guys bring her out.
Yes, it's definitely not in the average person's daily life. It's not normal to stumble upon a bright yellow Burmese python hanging out outside. So we like to have our other keepers and other staff out talking to the public and educating them about what we're doing as well. And it's also really good for the public to be able to see her and, you know, sort of interact with her at semi-close range. And that's what really creates that human-animal connection and gets people to care about animals and conservation.
Wow. She's beautiful, too.
Yes, she is.
The best part about being on for ZooView is that we actually get to take your questions since we're live on Facebook right now. We've got a couple coming in. Kaylee Aniston says, I read that Burmese pythons are one of the biggest snakes on the planet. How big did they get?
They can grow about 22, 23 feet long and weigh anywhere from 250 to up to 400 pounds, just depending on the individual. And they are one of the larger species of snakes. There's always a caveat to the question, what's the biggest species?
Right.
Because there is a longest species, which is the anaconda, and then there's also the biggest species, which are actually the reticulated python. They're the heaviest bodied snake. So whenever we get that question, we like to let people know that there are two different kinds, the longest and the heaviest.
So there's a lot of size here, so I imagine there's a big diet to back that up. What does Louise eat?
She gets a 5-pound rabbit every 3 weeks. She gets a larger meal less often because since she's really at her pretty much adult size, she doesn't need to eat as frequently. And because snakes have a slow metabolism and they don't burn a lot of calories, they don't need to eat as frequently. You know, we need to eat constantly throughout the day. We have a very high metabolism compared to reptiles.
Okay, so it just takes a little bit longer for them. Mindy asked, how do pythons eat? Do they bite or strangle their prey, or how do they do it?
They are constrictors.
Okay.
And so what she would do in the wild is she would be hunting a prey animal and she would be stalking it, and then she would grab it and constrict around it until it stopped breathing, and then she would consume it whole.
Wow. Okay. Mm-hmm. There's a question here, and it's an interesting one. It's coming from Kim. Is there a difference in the lifespan for being out in the wild or in captivity?
Generally, yes, because in the wild you have things like predation, you know, illness, things like that. And here at the zoo, we take great care of all of our animals. They have access to world-class vet care. And so any ailment that she would be experiencing, we've got a veterinarian, full-time vet staff here at the zoo. And so any kind of issue she's going to have, we're going to be able to take care of. And then obviously she also doesn't have any predators here at the zoo. So her lifespan can be up to 24, 25 years. So she's a 15 this year, and so she's got quite a bit of time left.
Nice. Hey, sweetie. Kelly is asking, do they only eat live food?
Well, in the wild, yes. Mm-hmm. But then here at the zoo, we do feed her a pre-killed rabbit. So it comes to us frozen, and then we thaw it out for her and warm it up. So then she, because obviously we don't want the snakes to eat frozen food. That's not good for their insides. Just like when you accidentally swallow an ice cube, it's very painful. For them, if they were to consume a frozen product, it would be quite painful.
Mm. You see the muscles and just the
They are very strong.
Very strong.
Yes. Whenever we weigh her, we put her around us, and you can feel her, you know, gripping on and holding on. She doesn't have arms and legs, you know, like a dog would when you hug your dog, you know, and they just kind of hang out with you. She doesn't have any arms to grip onto you, and so she has to wrap around you, and you feel her constricting. And so if you're not comfortable with that, it can be a little, you know, concerning, but she does a really great job, and she loves hanging out with us, and she's just going to come check us out and go exploring.
Nice. And you said that she's used to you handling her. Can we touch her real quick?
Yes, you can touch her right where you're at. You
just
can
right
certainly
here?
Touch her. Yep.
Wow. She's very cool.
And obviously she doesn't really seem to mind.
Nope.
And
thanks,
snakes,
Louise.
A lot of people think that snakes are slimy, and they really feel like a garden hose that's turned on.
Yeah.
They're very, very smooth. They're kind of cool to the touch, and they're not slimy at all. They're just shiny.
We just got another question asking, you know, does she shed her skin and how often?
She does. She sheds her scales about 4 times a year because she's larger. She doesn't need to shed as often because what's happening during the shedding process is they're growing. Mm-hmm. We shed our skin cells all the time. You know, you brush your arm off. There's, you know, thousands of them that just fell off. But they do it all at once, and snakes continue to grow throughout their entire lifetime. So that's the process that's occurring. Every time they shed, they're growing a little bit. So a younger snake is going to shed more frequently because their growth rate is higher.
Right. Just a lot of growing left to do. So you say that you do this about once a week. What's a normal day like? Whitney was asking for Louise. Does she play a lot? I mean, as much as a giant python would?
A normal day for her, you know, we come in the morning and take care of her. That might involve getting some enrichment that morning. All of our animals are on an enrichment program here at the zoo. It involves getting some misting time. She definitely enjoys getting misted, and she likes soaking in the water. And, you know, then we have a snake chat at 12:30. She seems to be responsive to that. When she, you know, senses us speaking outside of her enclosure, she does come out. So I feel as though she might be able to sense that. And then at night, kind of the same thing. You know, if she needs some extra enrichment or some interaction, we'll do that with her. But she really does seem to enjoy this outside time. So we try to get her out as often as we can.
Right. We know that these pythons aren't native to Kansas City, so
that Jamie, is correct.
Jamie is asking, where do they normally live? Where would you find these in the wild?
They are native to Southeast Asia, Burma in particular, thus Burmese python. And in the wild, they are also not this color. They are more of a chocolate brown and tan color. The pattern is the same, but Louise is what is known as leucistic. So it's basically an absence of color. A lot of people think she's albino, but albinism is a true absence of all color. So she would be completely white if she was albino. So in the wild, obviously, if you're bright yellow, you're going to get snatched up by a predator. You don't blend in very well. So, but here at the zoo, she's obviously very protected.
You never really think of what would the predator be of a giant snake like mm-hmm. this. So what would that be?
At this size, really just humans is what it is. So habitat destruction, humans, they are hunted for their skins. Obviously, she has a lot of skin for a snake, and she's a very beautiful color. So they are hunted for their skins. But when they're smaller, you know, things like birds of prey, any other animal that's a carnivore that could get a hold of them would eat them. When they're younger, they are mostly arboreal as well. But then as they grow and their weight increases, they tend to hang out more on the ground.
Okay. You know, we see a lot of stories about pythons. Some of them are negative, but it's usually when, like, someone tries to keep one of these giant snakes as a pet, and you guys say, no, that is definitely something you shouldn't do.
Correct.
What do you recommend? People just come to the zoo and see these and just kind of stay out of the snake game. There were much smaller options, I think.
Yes,
if you want to
yes. If you are interested in having a snake as a pet, because there is a lot of interest out there, we really recommend starting with something that is very low maintenance and easy to care for. And, you know, corn snakes are a great option. They don't have a lot of environment requirements, and they don't get really large. What happens is people see these, especially the yellow color. The yellow is very popular in the pet trade, and people want that as a pet. They want to be able to show their friends or say they have a giant Burmese python at home. And the reality of it is, you know, she needs a whole bedroom in your house, and she needs a lot of room to explore. The food to feed her can be very expensive. And, you know, just like what has happened in Florida, which I think people are very familiar with, the Everglades situation and Burmese pythons and reticulated pythons, people just couldn't keep them. And so they've been released into the wild. And since the Everglades is very much like parts of Southeast Asia, they are now flourishing. And they have really put a detriment to the native wildlife in South and Southwest Florida.
It's definitely something. She's someone you would come to visit, not so much
Yes.
take over your house.
Correct.
Nikki wants to know, how many eggs does a snake like this lay?
Burmese pythons can actually lay up to 100 eggs in one clutch.
Wow.
Which is quite a bit. Usually the average, for all the species in total, average clutch size would be anywhere from 10 to 30 eggs, but they can lay up to 100. It's a lot. So you'd have 100 little Burmese pythons hanging out.
Has she had any laid any eggs, or have you tried to breed?
She has not. She's not recommended for breeding, and she's not part of an SSP program, so we don't breed her. And sometimes some of our female snakes will lay eggs, just kind of out of nowhere in the springtime when it is breeding season. But she hasn't done that, so she's just living life at the zoo.
She's staring at us. Hey, Louise. James has an interesting question talking about Florida. How does that work with alligators, and then do they attack? Do they attack each other? How does that work?
I'm sure that lots of people have seen photos of Burmese pythons eating, like 12-foot alligators. And they would definitely try to eat a small alligator. And, alligators, they're kind of opportunistic carnivores. They would definitely try to eat, a Burmese python or another snake they could get their hands on. Because they are both predatory carnivores, they will tussle every once in a while. But the important part about if you see Burmese pythons in Florida is you need to report it to U.S. Fish and Wildlife so that they can come and handle that situation.
Right, let them take care of it.
Yep.
Anne-Marie wants to know, how long has Louise been here at the Kansas City Zoo?
She's been here since 2004.
Wow.
Yep, she was a donation, and we have had her since then.
Nice. So she is a veteran here at the zoo.
Yeah, she is seasoned.
Jordan wants to know, is she the only python here?
She is not. She's the only Burmese python that we have, but we also have a carpet python and a ball python as well.
Okay. And it was interesting you say, everybody thinks, oh, this is an albino, like you said, but there are subtle differences. And in the wild, like you said, camouflage-wise, this wouldn't fly.
Correct. Yeah, she would definitely stick out like a sore thumb and be snatched up right away because of this coloration.
We talk about eggs. I know that she's not having any little young ones, but Emmy was asking, how long do those eggs take to hatch? Like, what's the gestation period, I guess, for
it is 2 to 3 months. Okay. So, and a lot of that, I know that sounds kind of nondescript, but with a lot of reptiles, it really depends on the temperature, dictates the incubation time. And so 2 to 3 months is typically their incubation period. And you can kind of relate it back to a native species that we have, red-eared sliders, which are a type of turtle. Their incubation time is anywhere from 50 to 90 days, depending on the temperature. So it's been quite warm this summer, so it would be more on the 50 to 60 day range, whereas if it was a cooler summer, it'd be higher up to that 90 day range.
Oh, okay. We see her sliding around the grass here, kind of stretching out. Anna wants to know, how fast is she? And I mean, I bet the answer is not entirely fast. Like, she's fairly slow.
She's no cheetah, but she can be quite speedy when she needs to be. But her moving at this pace is definitely a sign that she's relaxed and she's just exploring. Also, the fact that she's just hanging out in kind of one spot, she's very relaxed and just enjoying the sunshine.
Nice. And yeah, I remember, just for those of you who didn't see at home, they brought Louise out in this giant cooler, and definitely she took a few minutes to just kind of warm up and get used to her surroundings.
Yeah, really once neat. She feels that sunshine coming in, and she knows what, because she knows what we're doing, she knows that she can go explore and hang out.
She's done this before.
This is
old hat to her. Frank wanted to know, Kaylee, how do snakes like this get their mouths so wide open to eat?
Well, their jaw isn't fixed. So our jaw, right here, we've got a hinge right here and we can't move it. So in snakes, they don't have that. And they have the skin right here on the sides of their mouth is extremely stretchy and very elastic. So they're able to basically open up the top and bottom part of their mouth and extend it as far as that skin will stretch. And the bones in their skull are incredibly strong and thick, and the muscles in their face are very strong. So when they are consuming a prey item, it may look too big, but they're able to really crunch it down using all those muscles and those jaw bones.
Wow, I mean, there's just so much power that she has in her. Avery wants to know, do these types of snakes, these Burmese pythons, climb trees, or are they mostly on the ground?
At this size, they're mostly on the ground. However, when they are younger, they do spend a lot of time in trees. They are semi-arboreal because it's safer up in the trees when you are a small snake. There aren't as many predators hanging out up there. And so they would really just need to worry about birds of prey snatching them up in the trees. But once they get to this size, they really would need a very large tree and thick branches to be able to hold their weight. So they do spend more time on the ground, but at this size, there aren't as many predators either.
Oh, okay. That's good to know. We talk about her color pattern. How rare is that?
Well, this color in the wild is not very common. However, in the pet trade, it's quite common. Because this is a desirable color in the pet trade, it has become very common. And a lot of people actually associate Burmese pythons as being yellow now because it's so popular.
Right. Well, yeah, when you hear that, you don't think camouflage for the jungle. You hear, Britney Spears has one around her neck at a
concert.
That
is what most people associate it with, yes.
Oh, my goodness.
They know her as the Britney Spears snake. So.
Well, if there was ever a title to have, I guess that would be it. But thank you so much for your time, Kaylee, and thank you, Louise.
Oh, you guys are welcome.
And if you ever want to come see her, you can catch her at the snake enclosure over at the Kansas City Zoo. That's it for Zoo View this week. Thanks for tuning in, everyone. Louise, take it away.
Yeah, we can bring a camp. Okay,